The universe is 13.8 billion years old. Human technological civilization, ostensibly detectable by aliens, is only a very tiny fraction of that, about a century. A blink of an eye to the rest of the universe. We are barely there for two reasons. The first is our signals that might tell aliens that we've hit radio haven't propagated out into the galaxy much further than about 100 light years yet. But those signals, which would appear intermittent to the aliens, since most of it would be radar, is one part. But the other is signal strength, and how through the inverse square law, radio signals get weaker and harder to detect the further away you are. This is actually a viable solution to the Fermi paradox in that aliens may simply not be broadcasting at high energy. This is a somewhat neglected solution, but a very practical one. After all, we aren't broadcasting at those energies, and we have very little need for that with our technology. We actually try to keep that down to save energy. In short, it's easier to listen than to scream. So make your receiver more powerful before you do so with your transmitter. Other than a few signals, anything we regularly broadcast that's easily detectable without a radio telescope the size of Manhattan in another star system isn't visible past about the closest 100 or so star systems, at least reasonably so, unless the aliens are looking exactly right at us. And even then, we do not repeat. So even those few powerful signals they might see once if they were looking at all hours of their day are wow signals. They did not repeat. But our day-to-day radio broadcasts, by and large, cannot reasonably be picked up much past a light year due to low signal strength. Well, maybe aliens are broadcasting the same way we are, and are everywhere, but not too close, and not broadcasting strongly. We'd probably never see them in that case. You could call this the ships passing in the night hypothesis, where the ships pass just a bit too far over the horizon and never see any lights from each other, yet they were both there nonetheless. But there is another rather vexing aspect to this that leads to a rather creepy potential reality. We may not last long enough for aliens to notice us at all. Even if they would be highly interested if they had detected us, and might have otherwise tried to make contact if they had. There are reasons to suspect that we as humans might not last forever as a civilization, and this involves everything from running out of energy to destroying civilization in a nuclear war. It's something many of us think about often, but there is another rather troubling aspect here that goes beyond that. There is a potential statistical problem here as well. This stems from a probabilistic argument, known as the Doomsday argument, or the Carter catastrophe, after astrophysicist Brandon Carter. The idea is this: if you suppose that the total number of humans that will ever exist is finite, fixed at some number, then any given person existing at a particular point in time will be linked proportionally to the total population of people that existed. Before moving on, there is a reason to think this is so. Before our evolution, there were zero humans in the history of the universe, which is most of the history of the universe. The universe eventually will become uninhabitable, meaning that there is a fixed number somewhere of the total number of humans that ever existed in the history of the universe, like it or not. This means that hidden within this is information that a current human should be aware of, pertaining to how many more humans lie ahead. A way to imagine this is a cookie jar that you can't see inside because it's painted to resemble Batman. I have baked a batch of 100 cookies in the shape of the bat signal, and in the icing I have numbered them all, 1 to 100, but I did not tell you how many I made. I then ask you to pick one from the jar. You randomly pick out cookie number 11 from the jar. I then ask you to estimate how many cookies are in the jar, and you know two things. There are at least 11, and the cookie jar is not infinitely large, so there is a finite number of cookies left in the jar. But that you pulled out a cookie with a low number tells you something. Since if there are a million cookies in the jar, it's highly unlikely, very terrible odds, that you would just happen to pick out a cookie with a low number. Not impossible, of course, but odds are you won't with that many available cookies. It's unlikely that you would pick out one of the highest numbers as well. Chances are you will pick a cookie numbered somewhere in the middle. This involves the mediocrity principle, and it works for people as well. It's unlikely that we would happen to exist at the dawn of humanity, which clearly we do not. People by definition did exist, but your chances of being an early one are low, and you are clearly not living in that time. It's also unlikely that you are living at the very end of human civilization, even though it does not seem that way at times. That doesn't mean it's impossible to win lottery odds, it's just unlikely at any given time. But that lets you estimate how much longer humans will last. If you go by philosopher John Leslie's estimates that about 60 billion humans have existed up until this point, it might in fact be more than that, it can be statistically estimated that there is a 95% chance that the total number of humans that will ever exist will be 1.2 trillion before the odds of continuing to exist get out of hand. Add in a bunch of assumptions such as a stable population and life expectancy, which are arbitrary really, you can then estimate that such an amount of future people will be born in less than 10,000 years, meaning human civilization ends in about 10 millennia, or it gets increasingly unlikely to continue on. Granted, this is a statistical argument that makes no small amount of assumptions, and there are many arguments against it. But by the same token, these types of statistical analyses were used famously by J. Richard Gott to estimate when the Berlin Wall would come down, and it did indeed come down within the time frame he predicted. It was also used in World War II to estimate the number of enemy tanks that existed based on their serial numbers. Two reasonably accurate results. This method has its uses. But there are also ways for it to be completely wrong. For example, it falls completely to the wayside if humans start colonizing the universe, and we end up with many, many different populations of humans all over the Milky Way, in which case extinction becomes almost impossible, until the dying universe forces it on all life still existing at the very end. Numbers of human civilizations work like this too. Give each settled exoplanet a number, and we realize that we are so early in the game that we haven't even started leaving our star system yet. We are still at 1 in that context. Shout out to the moon, but we still haven't colonized it yet. But with that comes the obvious. We living now are incredibly early in the game, holding the number 1. If indeed the number of settled human planets ends up in the millions in this galaxy. What really challenges this idea, however, is if you undermine the mediocrity principle, it's possible that it doesn't apply to what you're doing, something that the Great Silence seems to suggest, at least so far, that human technological civilization is not normal, and thus not subject to the principle. It also suffers from having to make all those assumptions, and if you change them, you get a different answer. But it does illustrate that outside of destroying ourselves, or getting destroyed by an asteroid, the odds of longevity may not be that great for a civilization overall. And that's where we can get to the aliens perhaps never knowing that we were ever here. Sure, you can beat the odds. That has to be said, but if not, then you may be invisible because you don't last long enough to be detected. One way of thinking about this is the perception of time. A fun way to think about it are the Ents from The Lord of the Rings, where J.R.R. Tolkien invented a group of tree herders, themselves tree-like, that work on much, much slower time frames than we or the hobbits or Sauron does. Don't be hasty. And just to say hello takes them forever. Well, what happens if that works for alien civilizations and they aren't as present-minded as we are and do not live in the moment as much as we do? That might mean that their idea of SETI searches also work on much longer time frames, and they only look every 200,000 years for evidence of other civilizations. That too might make sense in that it is entirely possible that we might have to search the Milky Way with SETI experiments for thousands of years before we see anyone. Well, in our case, SETI experiments tend to be rather short-lived and transient, as funding allows. So if you only have a chance of detecting an alien signal every 10,000 years, you can bet that we will not see that without dedicated, all-sky, round-the-clock SETI searches, which we are unlikely to do, at least right now. Well, maybe the aliens don't either, and never do out of practicality, and their time frame of communications is so slow that we don't see them either for the same reasons. We would simply miss each other, even though we were both there, like the ships over the horizon. But this time the horizon is the time frames in which we operate, which are different. But I think the spooky aspect here is that we simply missed the boat on this one, and we are in the category of civilizations that do not beat the odds and are a flash in the pan. That's more likely than not, so the universe may be populated with enough civilizations that do beat the odds to be everywhere, but weakly detectable, yet we don't make the grade and join the graveyard of civilizations for which there may have been many that simply did not make it. I think that is a humbling thought. In itself, even an advanced civilization may simply ignore us for lack of a coherent thought process. We don't really have much of a plan with existence on Earth and space exploration, and we've never really gotten everyone on the same page. So we've made it this far by working with what we had. A much more advanced civilization may think very differently, or learn to, and achieve greater results. They might look at us, if they can tell or even care, that we might not make it. And they may only care when we reach a certain level of technological development that is indicative of a further level of thought than our fractious thought currently allows. Who knows? But either by realities or statistical probabilities, we are in a precarious time where we might not be here populating this planet or any others in the future. Maybe we reset or go extinct, or some natural disaster like the asteroid ends it. But if so, that does not end the record of humanity. Our space probes in interplanetary and interstellar space will last billions of years, as will equipment left on the moon. And while Earth weathers and subducts almost everything, the record of humanity here may last far longer than we did. In which case, the destiny of our planet in regards to alien contact may be as an archaeological site of an ancient, extinct civilization. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently discussing Spooky Season 2025, getting closer to Halloween. So I have broken out the various orange festive holiday gourds and my Halloween decoration. I only have one, a moderately large fake spider that I can sit somewhere. So tell me in the comments below about your Halloween decorations, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer. And subscribe to my channel for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.